There's teddy bears and high school rings and old photographs that mamas bring. The daddies with their young boys playing ball. There's combat boots that he used to wear when he was sent over there. There's 50,000 names carved in the wall. There's cigarettes and there's cans of beer and notes that say, children who don't say anything at all. There's purple hearts and packs of gum, fatherless daughters and fatherless sons. And there's 50,000 names carved in the wall. They come from all across this land in pickup trucks and minivans, searching for a boy from long ago. They scan the wall and find his name. The teardrops fall like pouring rain. And silently they leave a gift and go. They're stars of David and rosary beads and crucifixion figurines and flowers of all colors, large and small. There's a Boy Scout badge and a merit pin, little American flags waving in the wind. And there's 50,000 names carved in the wall. There's 50,000 names carved in the wall.
Arena over there, coming over, and what were you doing in those days, sir, in the Air Force? What was your rank and your job?
Well, the first time I got involved with the program was in Vietnam.
Uh-huh.
I had been assigned to Strategic Air Command in Plattsburgh, New York, And I knew my time was coming to Vietnam, so I looked for a program to volunteer for. And a friend of mine mentioned Project Hawkeye. When I asked what Hawkeye was, he said he couldn't tell me. It was a classified project. And that piqued my interest
at
that
time. It sure did, didn't it? Yeah.
And so I got assigned to Vietnam with Project Hawkeye. I showed up the middle of August in 1965, and everybody at 2nd Air Division was very happy to see me because they didn't know what Project Hawkeye was. Unfortunately, I didn't know what Project Hawkeye was either. And it was not until about a week later that the project leader showed up in Vietnam and was able to brief us on what everything was.
Yeah. Well, did it make sense to you then?
Well, once I learned, although I was part of the first front-end crew, and we didn't really know what the people in security service were doing. We knew that they were monitoring communications. And I, as a navigator, was plotting direction, finding fixes. And of course, we knew it was the bad guys.
But well, now, did they do such things as like to turn left here, or turn right there, or slow down? How did they get the airplane to respond?
Well, it was, first I ought to mention some of the differences in the airplane because they were pretty interesting. In the original airplane, we didn't have a 360 degree capability, or not a very accurate 360 degree capability. So once we got a rough bearing, we had to turn 90 degrees to the target where the best accuracy was. And of course acquire a lot of these lines of bearings, and then you could plot the fixes. We didn't have a Doppler navigation system on that airplane, which amounted to anything. Instead, there was a hole in the floor, and it was intended that you would take a picture of where the airplane was at the time you got the bearing to the station. Well, of course, once we developed the first roll of film, it turned out to be all jungle. And no one knew where we were. So from that point on, we took the camera out of the airplane, we lay down on the floor, and we marked our position on a map, and then turned on this rudimentary Doppler system that we had. Yes, the navigator in the back of the airplane, once he had a bearing to the target, would direct the aircraft in a specific direction to optimize the lines of bearing. The prototype aircraft worked pretty well, and because of its success, the Department of Defense decided to buy some more Air Force airplanes. And I think in the end there was a total of 44 EC-47s built by Sanders Associates in New Hampshire.
Flying this specific mission?
Flying this specific mission.
From at least three or four different areas in Vietnam?
That's right. We had it in Saigon, Pleiku, Nha Trang, Phu Cat, Da Nang, and the Cam Phanom.
Well, during that period of time, were you formulating ideas about what you were going to do in the future? Did you know?
I enjoyed the work.
Okay.
So when my tour was over, I put on my dream sheet. I asked the Air Force if I could stay with the program. And unfortunately, they didn't assign me to it. So I went to the security service commander at that time, a fellow by the name of Bob Wallander, and he wrote a very long message to General Cora, who was the commander of security service, and said, I have a navigator and I have a pilot that have reflected interest in staying with this line of work. We should get them in security service. And General Cora carried this letter over to Randolph Air Force Base personnel, and our orders were changed, and we were assigned to Security Service Headquarters at Kelly.
Terrific, yes.
I stayed with the program for a long time. The first part of my assignment to Security Service after I got home was to do a roadshow for the Department of the Air Force. Having been on the first crew, and the Air Force, of course, being interested in advertising the capability of the airplane, put together a little dog and pony show, which I carried around to several commands in the Air Force and several bases. I also, following that, was assigned on temporary duty to the manufacturer of the direction finding system. Sanders Associates in Nashua, New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
And subsequently participated in the design, not as an engineer, but as an operational requirement kind of fellow for subsequent systems of this kind.
Mm-hmm. Did you stay in the Air Force as a lifetime career?
Yes, I did. I was in for 26 years.
Uh-huh.
Twenty-four hours a day, the Goonie Bird, relics of World War II, fly electronic snooping missions over South Vietnam and Laos. Fondly dubbed the Antique Airlines by the men of the 360th Tactical Warfare Squadron and the 6994th Security Squadron, these aircraft, under the code name Combat Cougar, are providing a highly effective electronic warfare system for locating frontline enemy transmitters in the Vietnamese War. Lieutenant Colonel Alan B. Thomas has this to say about their mission.
Our job is to conduct airborne radio direction finding operations against the enemy transmitters in the field, to gather intelligence from their transmitters, and while airborne, to relay this information to U.S. field forces. Our parameters, as specified by MACV, are accuracy, timeliness, and quantity. We strive, first of all, to position the fixes as accurately as possible, and this can be done to as close as 250 meters. Secondly, to rapidly pass the fixes to our field force customers. And thirdly, to get as many fixes as possible in a 7-hour flight.
1 hour and 15 minutes before takeoff, the crew receives a classified briefing. Intelligence, en route weather, operational data, scheduled times, and emergency procedures. The navigator and DF operator pass on to the crew the initial Doppler set point, heading to the assigned area, and information about the radio activity to be expected. The general location of enemy transmitters and specific targets on which friendly commanders have requested priority information is also passed on, as well as potential visual reconnaissance points. The C-47's minimum crew consists of pilot and co-pilot, the flight engineer, a navigator, and two DF operators. All must work closely together at all times, as the premium on teamwork is extremely high. Forty-five minutes before takeoff, the crew performs a normal pre-flight inspection of the aircraft. At 25 minutes, the engines are started. Immediately after takeoff, the initial Doppler settings are made using a set point, which may be as close as 5 miles. Benoit Bridge, for example, is frequently used for this purpose. Once the aircraft is airborne, the pilot levels off and warns the navigator at about 3 miles from the selected set point. The navigator, sighting through the drift meter, bomb sight fashion, directs the pilot to maneuver the aircraft directly over the set point for a visual fix. When visual sightings are not possible because of marginal weather, ground-based radars are used to establish position over the set point. This, of course, is not as accurate as the visual set. En route to the target area, the Doppler accuracy is verified against another selected set point, and the search for other targets of opportunity continues. Aircraft normally fly their day-night missions above 3,500 feet to avoid small arms fire. Descents to 2,000 feet to avoid clouds are occasionally made, but because of the nature of the equipment on board, flying below this altitude is not authorized. Once over the target area, the main job falls to the navigator and the two DF operators. Doppler accuracy is again verified on another set point and reset if necessary to give the most accurate information over the target. Working as a team, the navigator and DF operators concurrently feed data to what could be called a fourth member of the team, the printer. One DF operator searches for enemy transmissions. Although he will concentrate on certain pre-briefed frequencies, he must also scan the whole spectrum for unanticipated targets. With the desired enemy transmission displayed, the DF operator locks on and notifies the crew over the intercom with lock on, and then gives the signal strength reading. At both the navigators and pilots panels, the lock on lights illuminate, and the ARDF swings to indicate the enemy transmitter's bearing. At this point, the pilot must maintain level flight so that accurate readings may be obtained. Once the navigator has determined that all the displayed information is correct, he initiates a printout which combines the aircraft's position and time with the frequency, bearing, and strength of the enemy signal. Selecting the best combination of information from the tape, he uses this to plot the aircraft's position and bearing to the transmitter, thus giving him the first line of position, or LOP. Now the aircraft is flown into an area of stronger signal strength, and the same procedure is repeated for a second and third time, resulting in a fix. Verification is again made by checking the Doppler accuracy against the initial or another set point and correcting for any accumulated error. Meanwhile, the flight engineer is busy dropping Chui Hoy leaflets to cover the real purpose of the mission. He also observes the ground for any unusual activity. Typical of an incident was the spotting of enemy troops along a road. A forward air controller was requested, found unavailable, so the Artillery Control Center requested the aircraft to serve as artillery coordinator. Mission experience has shown that the optimum flight path for ARDF operation is a straight line. This requires the aircraft to be in position to receive an optimum signal from the enemy transmitter, thereby causing the ARDF needle to swing rapidly. When a minimum signal has been picked up, the aircraft is flown directly toward the target until the signal strength increases to near maximum. The closer the approach, the stronger the signal, and the further off the nose the pilot maintains the bearing. Thus, the cone of silence over the transmitter is avoided, which would cause the ARDF needle to spin or hunt, producing incorrect readings. Frequently, only two lines of position can be obtained before the transmitter goes off the air, but we don't disregard this information. In this case, we proceed to the next desirable LOP location. Then, if the transmitter starts to send again, we are in a position to obtain the third LOP and complete a fix that might have otherwise been disregarded. By flying a straight line path, there are no telltale maneuvers to alert enemy operators or ground observers to the purpose of our mission. Experience has shown that this procedure results in an ideal LOP with good angular separation. The straight line path also is the easiest to execute and employs the full 360-degree capability of the equipment. The ultimate goal of Combat Cougar is to provide our ground forces with enemy movement information in sufficient time to react effectively. For experienced crews, less than 10 minutes is not unusual. Fast reaction time, aided by electronic surveillance, is enabling our forces in Vietnam to counter the enemy punch for punch, day by day, in the battle with a faceless enemy who moves along undefined lines.
First thing I'd like to do is pay tribute to JC putting this together. I don't know if you had occasion to do this, but I think we owe him a round of applause for it's always great, but it's special to be with a group like this, and of course it's since I'm still involved with the government, both as a Beltway Bandit, and I do a lot of foregone government stuff. It is kind of nice to get out of Washington, D.C. I always think that my favorite line about Washington is the Harry Truman line, you want a friend in Washington, buy a dog. That seems to be very true these days. My wife, Sue, would have been with us here today, but she's busy grandmothering, and that these days takes first priority over anything else. She did remind me, though, keep it short. She reminded me of this time that she did go with me when I made a after-lunch speech. And she overheard a conversation at the table between this couple that was there. And, you know, I'd been waxing eloquent for, obviously, far too long, and this guy got up to leave, and she overheard this conversation between him and his wife. She says, "Where are you going?" He says, "Gotta get a haircut." She said, "What do you mean you gotta get a haircut?" "Why didn't you get that before you came in here?" "I didn't need it then." So she likes to remind me of that story. You know, I never, when I was younger, I always, I never quite understood what it was about when vet groups would get together. You know, when World War II vets or Korea vets would get together. I never quite understood, you know, what was the thing with the hats and everything else. And I think today when I came here, I finally understood that. I got some insight into that. And I think it has to do with a very, very special, unique bond that exists, that develops among people that go through an experience that we all did in performing this very unique mission. And it doesn't seem to matter that, you know, if you go 28 years, don't see anybody, and as soon as you see them again, that bond is instantly restored. And I've gone through that this morning with a lot of my guys from Party of Correction, I think it was Dead 3.
Yeah.
My troops from Dead 3. And it's just a very special, unique thing that I think one has to experience to really understand what that's all about. I guess the doc was talking about some of the, you know, the physical aspects. Maybe that has to do with the spiritual aspects of you know, what is it that attracts us to coming to this sort of thing, and the way we feel about it once we get here. I think it's really great that their family here, a lot of the spouses you know, who sort of went through with it, our experience with us vicariously, back in the States, keeping the home fires burning up or whatever. So it's great that you can be here with us. Certainly for me, in my particular case, I not to dwell on this, you know, too personal-centric, or certainly debt-free-centric, since I know we have people that were served in the other debts and front-enders and all that. It was a unique unit and a very unique mission. And of course, the debt three, where I was in Hong Kong Phnom, had a mission somewhat different from the units that operated in Vietnam, because units in Vietnam were actually supporting formal, organized military units in combat, whereas we in Laos were supporting a different kind of war, so-called secret war, where really our ground consumer was the CIA, and as they supported the elements of the Laotian scene that were opposed to the North Vietnamese and BC. So it was a very, very different mission, and the way we had to perform it was different at Death 3 than it was at the other deaths. It was my second tour in Southeast Asia. I'd done a year in Vietnam in 65 and 66, just as we started attacks up north, bombing attacks up north. Had the unusual experience then of winding up with my dad as my roommate. We just coincidentally had a 7-month overlap in our tours in Saigon. He was also a lifelong SIGINer, spent 28 years in the SIGIN business. And he was the deputy for the NSA office in Saigon. Somebody asked me, you know, why would you do that? So you move in with your dad. And I said, well, the main reason was he was a colonel, I was a first lieutenant, so my standard of living. Dropped precipitately the day he left. Certainly for me, though, I went back to the headquarters of Security Service, and in fact, I was all set to get out. I was so disillusioned in the first tour. I was all set to get out of the Air Force, and I had a big GS-11 job lined up for myself at NSA, and figured that's what I'd do. And but I came back here to San Antonio, to the headquarters, and by sheer happenstance, wound up as the aide commander of Security Service, then Major General Luke Coyer, who still lives there in town. And then after him, Major General Carl Stapleton. And So it was a great experience for me as a very young officer, young captain, to kind of sit around and watch what the commander of the command did. And so that's what we'll do. So I want to go through, you know, take a check ride, do all the routine, and I'm having a senior moment here. I cannot remember the name of the examiner 202 that was going to check me out. And I said, look, you know, just forget I'm the commander. You know, I'm just another analyst here. You know, be straight about this. My own pass. Clunk. So we did.
Dry and it's air conditioned, and we got a big
big civil engineer project to upgrade our dorms. We got air-conditioned dormitories, and a lot of things happen. Now, why did I bore you with all this story? Well, I think, to me, this, I didn't appreciate it at the time, but it really illustrated the importance of the mission that we were performing. Certainly, the conditions in which we had to perform that mission had become known to higher headquarters, real higher headquarters, as it turned out, and something got done to fix it. And I always remembered that because I thought it was a tremendous testimony to what we were trying to do. You know, it was a little dinky detachment, 100 guys in a castle, trying to do something that had national importance. And so our lot in life went up, our popularity on the base trickled down a little bit, but they had to be careful, take care of us. Another experience that Wayne Kimball, when we talked in the car driving over Security Hill, reminded me of, I sort of forgot about it, it was a profound experience. It was Christmas of 1970, and this is, it gets illustrative of the kind of bond that forms in an endeavor like this. And it was Christmas Eve maybe. And so we, by that time we had two full-fledged dormitories and we had sort of an H complex at Dep 3, and we had a little courtyard there. And Bruce Center, I just remember that name, was the first shirt. He had a real green thumb and it had the area looking beautiful. And so I had some USO ditty bags. So we had sort of a mini commander's call, and so I was handing out ditty bags to all the guys in the end who were available, maybe 50 or 60 of us then. And just without any prompting or anything like that, we sort of broke into Silent Night. And I'll never forget that. And I'm so glad that Wayne reminded me of that. And again, this is indicative of the bond. And, it was sort of bittersweet, but yet you're with your family.
As this procession of specialist aircraft developed, it could be seen that by Vietnam, time may have run out for the C-47. Eventually, ironically, its prime advantage was to be its versatility. It seemed that there would always be work for them as long as they could fly. In Indochina, one of the uses of the Dakotas was in electronic warfare. Here, highly trained technicians board a specially equipped C-47, which is probably older than any of them. The purpose of these special missions was to establish the coordinates of enemy radio from several different positions. Flying low and slow, the C-47 was an excellent platform to pinpoint exactly where enemy targets were. The information would then be transmitted to American bombers so that the steamy jungle of Southeast Asia was no longer able to provide an impenetrable cover for enemy troop movement. This type of operation was generally considered to be quite successful.